Father Jonathan over there is Sister Joanna Burley. Sister Joanna is the prioress, which means the head sister for you non-monastics, right, at the Benedictine Sisters of Virginia Monastery in Bristow. The sisters have ownership of St. Gertrude High School and another school in Bristow, Linton Hall. And then Sister Cecilia Dwyer, who is the head of school with St. Gertrude, and recently, prior to Sister Joanna, was prioress for a couple of years, I think. 28 years at the monastery in Bristow. So Sister Cecilia and I will lead the presentation this morning. We've got a little bit more than a dozen slides for you, which will provide some information about the announcement that we made this past Friday. And then after that presentation is over, we'll answer any questions that you all have. And we'll stay as long as you have questions. We'll ask you that when we get to that point to ask one question and then let somebody else ask one so we can be fair of everyone's interest and give everyone an opportunity to speak if they wish to do so. Start with slide number one. We are proud to be introducing a new educational corporation, Catholic corporation, called the Benedictine Schools of Richmond. If you don't know a little bit about the corporate structures of the two schools, they are a little bit different. Benedictine is separately incorporated from the Benedictine Monastery, from the monks here. Not so at St. Gertrude. St. Gertrude is a part of the corporation of the Benedictine Sisters. So this is it's a change in the corporate structure for both institutions. How is it a change? Well, it's click to the next slide here. The Benedictine Schools of Richmond is an umbrella organization that sits over top of both schools, right? So both St. Gertrude High School and Benedictine College Prep will continue to exist as single-sex institutions underneath this umbrella organization of the Benedictine Schools of Richmond. What does that allow? Well, it allows us to have a shared approach to Catholic education. It also provides us a single governance strand instead of currently we have two governance strands. And gives us the opportunity to bring the schools closer together, capitalize on some economies of scale, and find some educational program synergies that will allow us to actually enhance what we offer for both boys and girls. I'll get to a little bit more of the details in a moment on the Benedictine Schools of Richmond, but first we're gonna do some data. So again, Colonel, if you fall asleep, I can get you some coffee because we're about to do some data work here. This is not something that was cooked up in the last few weeks in a black box. Benedictine started a strategic planning process in the fall of 2016, which is a part of our normal accreditation cycle. And what we started looking at that time was what's in the future for Catholic school education? What's in this future for private school education? And, you know, part of the best predictor of the future is looking at the recent past. And so we looked at educational data, particularly enrollment data, for private schools and Catholic schools locally around the state and across the country. I'm going to share some of that information with you now so that you can kind of, it provides a good context for the decision-making process around this very exciting announcement. So a couple of the data sources that are really important to know. This one that's on the slide behind me, CARA, C-A-R-A, is the Center for the Applied Research on the Apostolate. It's an institute of Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. They do three things. One, they study vocations, the development of vocations in the Catholic Church. So men and women who are taking vows or being ordained into some aspect of religious life in the Church. The second thing they look at, is sacramental participation in the Church. So how many people coming to Mass on Sundays? You see those little guys with the round things clicking as you come in? They're not working for the U.S. Census Department. They're working for the Catholic Church. And they're reporting that to the diocese, which all gets reported up to CARA. And they publish that information for the benefit of the Church to study what's going on in the Church. They also look at how many children are being baptized each year, how many young men and young women are receiving First Communion, etc., etc. The purpose of all that is for the Church to study itself. Kara doesn't make any judgments, offer any opinions. They just report data. You can find it. It's all on the internet. So this particular slide is relative to the third thing that they study after sacramental participation, which is Catholic school enrollments. And this is a nationwide study. The earliest date you'll see on the x-axis down there is 2003, runs to 2014. I've got the 2014 to 2019 data as well, if you're interested. It's in my brain, not on the sheet up here. But what this shows you is enrollment at religiously affiliated schools around the country during this period. You'll see at the bottom here, you've got schools that are affiliated with churches, schools that are not, some that are labeled conservative Christian, others that are non-sectarian. The top line is the important one. Right. Those are Catholic schools. So good news, right? There's more kids enrolled in Catholic schools in the country than any other type of religious education. Bad news, there were 2.5 million students enrolled in Catholic education in 2003 and 2 million in 2014. That's a 20% decrease in a 10-year period, right? I see a lot of business owners in here, right? If you saw a 20% decline in your revenues in 10 years, you'd probably be concerned, and rightfully so. What's this data from, someone asked in one of our first sessions, what's the data from 2014 to 2019? An additional 12% decrease during that period, right? This is nationwide. Richmond, our little metropolitan area, is doing better, but not a lot better, right? It was about 20% decline nationwide during this period. It was a 15% decline in the Richmond metropolitan area, right? So these are things that we wrestled with and understood. Our enrollment situations have also been impacted. In some cases, not as severely, in other cases, significantly. The next piece of data that we looked at was sacramental participation. A little bit of a complicated slide here, but what this shows is compares Catholic school grade level cohorts between 2013 and 2000, and how many children in those grades were baptized into the church. As you see these red numbers here, red is not good on an income statement or a balance sheet, and it's not good here when you're talking about people receiving, being baptized in the church either. Right, so where are these children now? Where are they today? These are our current 10th graders, 9th graders, and middle school students. Right? There's lots of reasons we could attempt to, you know, digest or understand that lead to these numbers. But the bottom line is there are less children being baptized into the church today than there was 13 years ago, and significantly less. This slide is related to a market study that the school completed, Benedictine completed, as a part of its strategic planning effort. And so after we digested kind of what's going on in these different regions with enrollments, Catholic and private, we went out to the our primary market, not our sole market, but our primary market being the parochial schools of Richmond. If any of you had children enrolled in St. Mary's, St. Benedict, St. Edward's, Our Lady of Lourdes, All Saints, etc., over the last few years, you got this survey. It came from your school principal in the email asking you to fill it out about the future of Catholic secondary education in Richmond. There are 1,200 families who enroll about 2,200 students in those parochial schools, right? Of the 1,200 families, almost 800, 793, responded to this survey. For any of you stat geeks out there, right, that is a 99% confidence, less than 2% margin of error survey. That's pretty darn good, right? What these people say is what people, parents, think in parochial schools in Richmond. And parochial school students, yeah, they don't make up our whole population, but they make up 60% of our population, not a group that you can ignore. One of the questions that we asked among many in the survey was, would you be interested in what we defined as a coordinate program? So what does a coordinate program mean? It means an all-girls school co-located with an all-boys school on a campus that shares some resources, some athletic facilities, you know, some other fixed costs, perhaps some other, you know, overhead like technology expenses, accreditation fees, you know, things that we, you might say, duplicate between the two schools currently. We did not mention St. Gertrude's as being the school in this coordinate program because that would have been presumptuous and unfair. We just asked the concept, this concept, how would you feel about that? Would you consider enrolling your son or enrolling your daughter? Right? This particular subset of the data is about 55% of the respondents because, and we categorize them as maybes, because the first question we asked folks was, have you made a decision where you're sending your child to high school? And some people said, yes, I've made a decision, right? They're going to Trinity, they're going to Collegiate, they're going to Benedictine, they're going to St. Gertrude's. We pulled those people out of, you know, this response piece of data here because they've made up their mind, right? The people we're trying to influence are the undecided future customers, which was the majority of the respondents. This was the answer to that question. Over 90% said families with boys said we would be interested in a solution like that. And over 76% of families with girls, right? Those are high percentages. And it's our suspicion, had we been able to say at the time that St. Gertrude's was the female component of this question, those percentages for girls probably would have been much closer to the percentages for boys, but nonetheless, they're still very, very high.
Jesse, what's the timeline again on that survey?
This was the fall of 2017, so a little more than 2 years ago. Now I'm going to turn it over to Sister Cecilia, and she's going to talk about what does this all mean.
Good morning.
Yes.
First of all, let me welcome you on behalf of St. Gertrude's and the Benedictine Sisters. And Jesse's been headmaster for 10 years, and I have been head of school for St. Gertrude's for 6 months. However, as prior to the community, I was president of our Board of Trustees for 28 years. So I'm a graduate of St. Gertrude's. So I'm very familiar with the school and with Benedictine. And remember all the years when I was at St. Gertrude's and we walked up and down the alley for science classes and for the gym. And so the relationship I feel with Benedictine is very close. So what it means, big mean move to St. Gertrude's is relocating to this campus. So you can imagine that's quite a cause, I won't say consternation, for some people it is, because there's a lot of emotion tied into the building, the tower, the chapel. When we told our students last Friday about this, the first question they asked was, what about the chapel? Which I was happy for, because they're very aware of that, but anyhow. So we will move. The move will commence for the 21-22 school year. So next year, the 2021 school year will still be on our campus, and life will go on as usual, except we'll be working during that year to have more commonality. You know, and behind the scenes, we'll be hiring people, we'll be working on how we're going to coordinate the program. So we are going to build a new building for the girls. It's very exciting. And we hope to have that finished for the 22-23 school year, which will be our 100th anniversary. Is that a great anniversary present or what? The thing we really want to emphasize is that each school is separate and single sex. We're going to continue. So it's like we're going to pick up and move out here, but we're not merging. We're not gonna interact in terms of classes. We're going to be single sex. So no co-ed classes, with the exception of perhaps, you know, I always use the like AP calculus. We will both be able to offer more AP classes if we could take the kids from both schools to put in them. Because right now we don't have enough to have the class. So I think that'll be a great benefit to our students. There will be separate dining facilities, and we will be sharing athletic facilities. Excuse me. We have to give our school a tour of your campus. Definitely have to make a road trip. But we have your wonderful gym, which our girls will share, which has been built with girls in mind, locker rooms, offices, sleeves for volleyball nets, and three basketball courts. So I think our girls will be quite happy in sharing that facility. Each school will keep its name. So although the corporation will have a new name, the Benedictine Schools of Richmond, there will still be a St. Gertrude High School and there will still be a Benedictine College Prep. And we're going to have a new organizational structure, which we'll show you in just a moment. So Jesse walked this off, to be very exact with you all. So for nearly a century, our two schools, Jesse says, were 400 feet. Now I've noticed his feet are a lot longer than mine, so I'm not sure how he measured it. But so about 400 feet apart for all those years, almost over 90 years. For the past 7 years, we've been 14 miles from each other, which has really cut back on our social interaction, our ability to come to one another's activities. And hopefully, soon, we will stand 600 feet from each other. Jesse will show you the location.
If you're wondering that 400 feet, that's if, like sister said, if you go alley to alley, you all know the alley that connects St. Gertrude to Benedictine. Not that far. So where does the 600 feet come from? We're looking at a couple possible locations for the new girls' school out here at the Benedictine Abbey campus. So I'm going to talk about those. I'll tell you that we've considered a number of locations beyond just these two, but eliminated some along the way. And part of that rationale was based on preserving the distinctiveness of the two school programs, which Sister mentioned just a moment ago. So, for example, at the beginning of this process, we considered some options where the new girls' school building was actually connected to the current building. And some of the rationale there was, maybe we'll share more than we're talking about sharing right now. For example, maybe we would share the dining hall. That was a discussion at the beginning of this process. We very quickly decided, no, that's not a good decision, because that time is very important to the boys, to be boys. That's kind of their silly time, and you know, when they do the things that are funny and part of their orientation program that they really enjoy. And that's, you know, also a time to kind of let their very short hair down and relax in the middle of a very busy school day. And the girls likewise, right? That's a very important social and community time for the girls. And once we made, you know, some decisions like that, these other options really came into clarity and as preferred choices. I'm going to talk about two of those right now. They're listed up. I know it's a little bit hard to see, and some of you may not be completely familiar with this campus, or at least how it appears on a map. So here's your north-seeking arrow right here. This is River Road. Running down the western border of our property is Route 288, the highway that runs from Petersburg up to Short Pump. This is the James River down here, and this is the Pembroke Farm residential community, which is our eastern border. And so option A, so where is option A, right? Option A, this is on the ridgeline on the south end of our property. And you know, why is that significant? Well, if you're familiar with this area of the Richmond, kind of metropolitan area at all, and you looked up and down these this corridor, where you would find the most, you know, significant and I would say, you know, probably beautiful homes is along this terrain feature here. This isn't a topo map, so you can't really see that, but this is a ridgeline that runs south, right, runs east towards Richmond. Put that over there, Mike, thank you. If you want that coffee, there it is. That ridgeline offers a lot of beautiful views, gorgeous views of the James River Valley and the Palatine countryside on the southern side of the river. If you're not that familiar with this area, a lot of the land on the south side of the river is floodplain, so it's pasture land, it's agriculture. It's gorgeous, right? It is a, you know, really a very scenic place. If you'd like to know where Justin Verlander lives, the next time you're coming across 288 North on the Veterans Memorial Bridge, look to the right, and you'll see his home and a lot of other homes along this same terrain feature, right? So something that's very attractive as a possibility from that sense. There are some other rationales for this being option A as well. You'll see a couple of fields back here, athletic fields, which we know that we need to build. These don't exist right now. There is a field in the back named after one of our English teachers, Joe Arnold. But there also will be a softball field and an additional athletic field which doesn't currently exist. We know that we need one more field to accommodate the girls here on campus. And those are listed there as field, and you see another one as softball. If you're not familiar with this property, the tennis courts are back here, which for many years prior to the OAC's existence, the girls used those tennis courts. That was where they played tennis, the girls from St. Gertrude. And so this piece of property, with its proximity to the gym, its proximity to this building, our auditorium, of course, which will serve the girls' drama, choir, and theater programs, all puts kind of that important pieces of functionality in kind of the same general area to serve the girls. And we are adding some new parking lots back here with the gymnasium construction, so there'll be about 150 parking spaces on this part of the campus, which is a few more than they have at St. Gertrude's currently. I think they have about 20.
Maybe.
Yeah. Yeah. So, significantly increased, access, not just to athletics, but that is important, but also to parking and really just a very attractive site that could provide for some special community spaces, dining halls, libraries, meeting places that would just offer some really fantastic opportunities for the girls. The second site that we're considering is option B, right? So if you're wondering where this is, so this is the football field. There's the track. That structure right there are the bleachers at Bobby Ross Stadium. You may not have ever noticed this, but when you're driving out today, take a look. Behind those bleachers is actually a fairly large grass field. We don't use it for anything. There are some little kids that use it to play football during our when the real football games are going on. So for those folks, it would be missed. But as far as the school goes, we don't use that property for anything. There's some pros to that as well. One, it's a flat green field, right? So from a site work perspective, it's fairly easy to build upon. It's on the front of the campus, right? It would have very easy access to these fields out here, much closer access to the church, which we will share, which is in the front of the school. There are some cons, though, as well, right? So it's kind of awkwardly presented on the campus. So as you're driving at it, you'd be approaching it from the side or, in an oblique fashion, which wouldn't really allow for a very good or, attractive view of a very significant building. It's a smaller footprint that's available, as you can see, compared to this one, which means necessary to go up three stories there in order to get the desired square footage. Not necessarily a cost impact. It's cheaper to build up than it is to build out, but not architecturally consistent with the rest of the campus. Some pros, parking here as well, right? Access to student parking. So these are the things that we're considering. I'd like to say one thing that I think is really important to note. Sister Cecilia, perhaps Sister Joanna, will mention this in a bit. Both, not just the schools, but the religious communities have been incredibly generous in this entire process. The sisters, they own the property, multiple properties actually, in downtown Richmond. The main one, of course, being the school building property, and are going to be very generous, have committed to be very generous with the net sale proceeds of those properties and putting those resources to this new school building for the girls. It's really humbling. Secondly, the monastic community here, the monks here, have also been very generous. This is their land. This is their property. And they've had dreams and visions with how they would develop this land. And they've been very generous in agreeing to commit, you know, a piece of this land. And if it ends up being option A part of what was their vision and dream for the future of these girls. And, you know, so there's gains for both the sisters, right, and the monastic community here, but there's also sacrifices. And I think appreciating those is very, very important in this process. Sister, would you like to take the leadership structure of the new corporation?
And I just thought something I forgot to say earlier. The Benedictine Schools of Richmond, the Benedictine word is not for Benedictine College Prep. It's because our two orders are Benedictine orders. And the school's philosophy is based on the values of the Benedictine order. So that's where the word Benedictine is coming from. Our Benedictine order is 1,500 years old. It's the oldest order in the church. And it's spread all over the globe. It's a force of nature in the church, really. Men and women's abbeys, monasteries. There are 50 women's monasteries in the United States alone. And we're all independent of each other, loosely organized together. But anyway, I just wanted you to know why we chose the word Benedictine. Leadership structure. As a single corporation, we'll have a single board. We'll have a single president to oversee the entire corporation, to be the fundraiser, to be the person who keeps our philosophy alive and in place. And then we will have a principal to coordinate the two school structures. It doesn't mean that both structures have to be exactly alike. They're very different right now in terms of how our class schedule works. But the principal will keep us on track as a Catholic Benedictine school and keep the academic track viable for both schools, to help the teachers work together to make sure that we are up to par in all of our standards. And then there will be a head of school for each school. So overarching, a board, a president, a principal, and then St. Gertrude's has a head of school, and Benedictine has a head of school, as two separate single-sex schools.
I think one of the important things to point out that's gained for our students, right, in this structure, is there's an increased focus on administration, right? And when I say administration, I mean leadership, right, for the schools. These positions exist right now. These do not, right? And, you know, for those of you who are Benedictine folks, right, you know that, you know, in my position here right now, I'm doing a lot of fundraising, a lot of, you know, financial management, strategic planning, and those activities, which are very important to the future of the school, they remove me from the boys and the daily life of the school. And I'm sure likewise at St. Gertrude as well. And part of the great opportunity here is a chance to provide more leadership for our young men and for our young women, and more focus on them through those leaders. So it's a different structure, right? It's a different distribution of responsibilities. Some very externally focused, some completely internally focused, but also synergizing the efforts of those schools to find opportunities for the kids that don't currently exist. Sister?
So for are there St. Gertrude's alums here? Yay, one, okay. I'm talking to you. So for our current school enrollment, the senior class will not be impacted by this at all. They're like bummed out about that. They would love to share in this excitement. The junior class of 2021, will not be impacted because we're going to be in place next year. But the class of 2022 will be moving on to this campus. We won't be ready with the building yet, so we will be having modular classrooms, which the county calls learning cottages. That's the official name for a modular classroom. Learning cottage. These are not your typing trailers. These are their classrooms. They're big, they have hallways, they have bathrooms. So they're temporary, but they're very substantial. We're going to try to get a picture to show you one of these days. And we hope by the 22-23 school year that we will have the new building ready. So many parents of the sophomore class, which will be impacted by the trailers, or the modular classrooms, are worried that their children will have a senior year in temporary housing. It's really not going to work that way. What we've talked about doing is not to say the girls are going to be in the temporary building, but to say maybe the math department is going to be in the temporary building, so that the cadets classes and our student classes will go to the temporary building for whatever their math classes are. So do you understand that? So in other words, both Benedictine and St. Gertrude's will share the temporary classrooms until we get the new building built. So 22-23 school year is our 100th anniversary. So this is going to be a nice way to celebrate it, moving into a new building. So you all start praying now that we get this building built by then. Please.
This last part of the presentation is our commitments, right? The things that we believe in and that we are committed to in this very exciting future. And one thing I'll point out before I forget, as you leave, please take a copy of one of these up here at the front. This is our educational philosophy. We've worked on this for 6 months. And so what is educational philosophy? Well, the not so exciting part is when you go through the accreditation process, which officially makes you a accredited private school, the first accreditation standard is your educational philosophy. So the folks that their responsibility is studying schools and improving their worth and giving that message to the state of Virginia. They think this is the most important document. I would say from a philosophical standpoint, this is really important because this is the why you are choosing to educate and the what that you believe in. I would argue that whenever you're going to do anything, you ought to know why you're going to do it and what you believe in. You can get basketball and geometry in any public high school in the country. What we're offering, the most important thing that we offer, is a spiritual formation. A spiritual formation for young men and a spiritual formation for young women. And if we are doing a good job of that, which we think we are, then we do want every student that we can get to be enrolled in this school so we can develop them as young men and young women of character. So the first thing we're going to talk about is single-sex education. Hopefully, in this presentation, and again, when you read this philosophy statement, you will understand, you'll walk out of this room knowing of our commitment to that. I think, and it was an important part of this discussion, that these locations, right, for the girls' school, they demonstrate that. They're obviously independent schools. Probably the biggest concern or question that we fielded throughout this process is this some sort of soft move to co-education? And the answer is no, it is not. We put single-sex education distinctively in the foundational documents of this new corporation, right? Kind of codifying our commitment to it. We've made it a very significant part of the educational philosophy that the schools believe in. And we've chosen sites for the girls' school and how this new corporation will operate to support that commitment to single-sex education. So I can't emphasize that enough. We're also going to honor the traditions of both schools, right? And there are a lot of them. Some of those are shared, some of them are not, right? There's no boys that sing in the song contest, and there are not going to be. And there are some traditions that are uniquely Benedictine that are for the boys, and there's not going to be girls in them. There are some that are shared between the two schools. We like them, they're important to the history of the two schools and their alumni and alumnae bases, and we will continue those. So it's very important that you know that as well. We're also committed to our missions. Another question, we haven't got it often, but we have received it, is will you abandon the mission statements of the schools and just form one mission for this new corporation? The answer is no, right? Those missions were designed, they were written, and they are lived out specifically for boys' education on the Benedictine side and girls' education on the St. Gertrude side. If we didn't believe that boys and girls were different, we wouldn't be running single-sex schools. But because we do believe that, they have different missions, right? They have different sets of outcome goals to a certain degree in the development of a young man in this very important time of his life, and likewise for a young woman. So we're keeping the distinctive missions of the schools, but we're also going to celebrate and respect the fact that there is more that is common between us that maybe is different, right? The principal thing is our faith, right? We are schools grounded, right, in a Christian formation, connected to Mother Church through the Benedictine Order, and we will continue to enjoy that, respect that, and celebrate in our liturgical practices and sacramental participation and prayer services that connection to the church and that Christian formation. It's so important to our schools. And also our connection to the Benedictine charism. As Sister said, the Benedictine order is the oldest in the church. There aren't many institutions that have been around for 1,500 years. Not the United States of America, not even the royal family, as we've seen in the last week, right? It is a very unique institution, and that charism animates us with its core values. Sister, you want to take high-quality education?
So the education we see as an investment in our students' futures, and we feel like together we'll be stronger and able to provide an even more solid education than we already are. Our St. Gertrude students will definitely benefit from the physical setting, from the state-of-the-art facilities. I know that you know how landlocked we are, and with our half a city block that is completely there's nowhere for us to go on our campus. And even though our girls are experts at parallel parking, when I come in the morning, I'm amazed. I come down Stewart Avenue and I turn on Tilden Avenue and I see them everywhere, expertly parallel parking. I think the neighbors, you know, get out as soon as they can so the girls have their places, but it's quite a challenge. It's very much of a challenge in the evenings, especially when we have evening events, because the neighbors are home, so there's nowhere to go. But so we will certainly benefit from a new building. Education has changed so much and requires so much of what we call state-of-the-art facilities. So to prepare our kids for college, we really need to be able to change our building quite a bit. Some of this will allow our community to put down new roots, also outside of Richmond, but maintain the roots that we have in the city. And I have to tell you that some of our parents are kind of upset about our moving out of the city because they put their daughters in our school because of its closeness to the museums, closer to the poor. Many parents express that, wanting their children to experience diversity. So we'll have to work really hard to keeping our Our diversity ratio is almost the same as Benedictine's. We are 28% minority, and we're very proud of that, and we really want to maintain it. So we're going to have to do a lot of work, I think, with transportation to be able to maintain our diversity, because that's really important to us. And we hope, as a matter of fact, I think we're pretty sure, that this move will increase the opportunities in the enrollment for both of our schools, because I think people will see it as a real plus. And it'll enable us to offer more electives and more AP courses, because we'll have a broader number of students, and we'll be able to afford to have teachers for those courses. Actually, we used to do that. I don't know if any of you all remember, but when the two schools were so close together in past years, we shared AP courses. I remember Latin in particular being shared. Right now, we don't have enough students to take Latin, to have Latin 1 and 2. We have 3 and 4, but not 1 and 2. So hopefully on this campus, we'll have enough students for some of those classes that we'd like to offer, but don't have enough kids for the teacher.
Okay. Strengthening Catholic education.
Right. So the common culture and community of our school is basically, first and foremost, Catholic. We use the diocesan curriculum, and we go to diocesan meetings, and we're very connected. As a matter of fact, two weeks ago, we went to visit Bishop Mestout and showed him our plans, and he is so happy, really excited about our doing this. I think he sees that it will make, basically, we're the first choice for Catholic high school education in Richmond, and there are very few choices for that. So I think he sees this as a real plus for the diocese. And Kelly Lazaro, the superintendent of schools, was there, and she actually came here the other night for a session to support us. They're just really happy at the diocesan offices. We're working together with our Benedictine culture, as we said. The values of the Benedictine culture are really basic humanity values. Community, respect, diversity, hospitality, stewardship. Those are basic values. We don't have a claim on them, but we promote them. It's what we're all about. So we will make that a foundation of the work that we do with our students. And in doing so, we're nurturing our community, but we're really nurturing the Catholic community in Richmond. And that's why we want to do this, to keep that alive.
And this is a really important piece as well, the stewardship of resources. Just to give you a little perspective on our schools as businesses, right? Much like any business out there in the for-profit world, right? There's opportunities for economies of scale. I mentioned some of those earlier, but you just take a room like this, for example. Right? This is a 5,000 square foot facility, probably bigger than most of our homes. You know how much it costs to heat and cool your home each year. It's not cheap, right? Multiply that times the ratio that equals 500,000, excuse me, 5,000. This is an expensive room, right? It's a shared resource. Then you have to clean it. Then you have to maintain it. Add in a gymnasium, a bunch of grass fields that you mow on probably a far regular basis than, more regular basis than we mow our own yards, and treat them and all of that. There are a lot of sunk cost resources that you might say are duplicated between the two schools. There's also overhead, between the two schools as well. Those synergies have the opportunity to do one very important thing, which is reduce expense per student, right? And so what is expense per student? That's how much it costs to educate one child in either of our schools. And so often I'll get either a request from our staff or maybe a parent like, well, we just need one more person over here, or we just need to buy this thing, right? I'm sure St. Gertrude's gets those same requests from their folks, and really all schools do. The challenge is, right, we're not profit centers, right? We're not for-profit corporations. We're not for profits. 85% of our budgets, probably about $5 million a year, on average between the two schools, total budget, is occupied by salaries and benefits for employees. And so one of the great challenges of organizations that operate in our space, which is really a small school space. Benedictine is larger than St. Gertrude's at the moment, not always the case in our histories. We have started the year with 262 students. That is a small school, a tiny school. St. Bridget's is bigger than Benedictine, right? St. Mary's is bigger than Benedictine. In fact, every other private high school that you would think of as our competitor in Richmond is bigger than Benedictine and bigger than St. Gertrude. With greater enrollment comes better economies of scale, which allows you to focus on cost per student. And that is what allows you to do one of two things, right? Either invest in your programs or manage the increases of high school tuition. And both of those things are important. The only way to add programs, add personnel, right, improve the quality of your life is, for a student, is enrollment must grow to support those things, or somehow, magically, costs must go down so you can repurpose expenses from one place to another place. The magic, you know, doesn't exist, right? There is no magic, right? Human beings expect a raise every single year, generally. If there are any human beings that work for me who don't want a raise next year, please come and let me know. And, you know, we can repurpose that expense somewhere else. That is the expectation of employees in every business in America. That means that your total expenses are going up every single year. So either your enrollment must be going up or your tuition must be going up. The only other way to, you know, tackle those challenges is through economies of scale. And this opportunity provides not just the opportunity for economies of scale, I'd say more importantly, the opportunity for enrollment growth. And the combined effect of those allows, one, investment in our programs for our kids, and two, the ability or opportunity for us to control the rising price of tuition in private schools. And lastly, a commitment to growing our schools, right? Just kind of dovetailing on that last slide. It is our intent to grow, right? Historically, St. Gertrude's has probably been closer to Benedictine's enrollment, right? About 250 to 270 students. Together on this campus, we have 440, we will have 440 students if you just took the two schools together today. We have the opportunity for 110 students of growth. Why 110 students of growth? When we moved out here, Benedictine, 7 years ago, we had to get a conditional use permit from Goochland County. That permit has a bunch of covenants that go along with it. Last week, prior to our announcement, Father Jonathan and I went